To look up at the sky on a dark, clear night is a jaw-dropping and humbling experience. It makes you wonder where we fit in all of this. I'm Leilan from ESA Education, and today we're going to speak to an ESA astronomer to find out more about our place in the universe. Tereza Jerabkova. Did I say that right?
Yes, yeah. You said it perfectly.
Welcome, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for having me. I'm really happy to be here.
So what do you do at ESA?
I work at ESA as a research fellow, which means 100% of my time is dedicated to do research. And I work on star formation. So I'm trying to understand how stars form, how they evolve, and in which groups they are forming. If we, for example, can see some star clusters, how they evolve.
How did you understand our place in the universe? Like where the Earth is in the solar system?
If we look at the solar system, we live on Earth, but there are other planets as well. Some of them are closer, some of them are bigger, some of them also have moon, some of them have actually many more moons. And with all of this, we orbit around Sun. There are also smaller objects called asteroids and minor planets. They are all over the solar system. They are also very distant objects in a Kuiper belt that actually are on a very different orbits and can become a comet when they come close to the Sun. So in order to understand the scales a bit better, as a ruler, we can use the speed of light and how long it would take the light to travel from different parts of solar system. So if we are on Earth, it would take us 1 second to reach the Moon. It takes 8 minutes to get to the Sun, and it would take more than 4 hours to reach the outer parts of the solar system. So maybe in a sort of more common analogy, we could see that our solar system fits into one house, then the outer parts of it would be the garden. And then we would like to visit our closest neighbor, which would be the closest star to the Sun. So it would take us with the same velocity, the speed of light, around 4 years. And that's the closest star to us. And then there are billions of other stars, billions of other houses that actually create a galaxy. And they are not randomly distributed, but they are villages. These can be small star clusters, but they are also really big cities. And these would be more massive and more dense star clusters. And the centers that are the densest, you can see it as the downtown area of a big cities with the high tower houses with lots of apartments in them.
And then these different cities, they would form sort of states and countries. These would be galaxies.
Yeah, exactly. So if a city would be star cluster, then indeed we could distinguish the galaxy from a star cluster in a way as we have cities and states, because they are different objects.
Typically, astronomers use telescopes to take pictures, that also give us measurements. But how is it that we can understand how heavy a star is or how fast it's moving from an object that we can't actually put on a scale and weigh?
This is a very good question, and maybe I can come up with another analogy in this way. So the thing is, how actually we study stars? Stars are born, then they evolve, they age in a similar way as we do, and then they die. But we just can take pictures. So how does this work? So the way we can study stars would be similar in earthly matters. If we would get a task, imagine that you are at school and the teacher tells you, okay, you have now 1 hour to learn about dogs, everything you can, but you cannot use internet or anything. You have just 1 hour. And I want you to figure out what dogs they are, how can you determine how much they weigh and what's their age. So you can then quickly take your bike and a camera and run all over the city and take as many pictures of dogs as possible. Then you come back to the classroom and then you can have a look at the pictures. And then there will be pictures of number of dogs playing in the groups, like stars and star clusters. And then some of these dogs will be alone, and some of them are big, and some of them are small. But you face all of the problems that, for example, you have two small dogs. One is a puppy, because puppies are small, because when a dog is born, it's small. But they're also a small breed. So it can be older Chihuahua, for example. And then you need to come up with the features, how to actually distinguish whether it's a puppy or Chihuahua. Okay. So then your estimate of the mass, just based on the information, would be different. And this is the type of research that actually we do in astronomy. We take all of these pictures and then we try to see, okay, this star is similar like Sun. It has a similar light. So probably it will weigh the same as Sun.
Tereza, why do we care about the size of a star, about its weight, about how fast it spins in a galaxy that's billions of light years away from us?
That's a great question. And actually, when I now think about it, we did always cared. I would say that we can define astronomy as a field that is studying every object that we can see at the sky. So it can be sun, it can be planets, but also other stars and galaxies. It was actually crucial for our survival. So, for example, when we started to travel on the sea and the ocean in between the continents, we needed stars for the navigation, otherwise we would always get lost. In addition, the knowledge of seasons and tides and the weather in general was crucial to harvest and create food. So actually, all of the astronomy in general and the knowledge of celestial bodies helped us to create a society that we have today.
Now, is astronomy something you were always inspired by as a kid, or what was your path to astronomy?
I was actually born in a small village in the mountains, so I did lots of sports. I did skiing, I played football, and I was not really thinking about any scientific career or anything for a very long time. Only just before when I had to decide what high school I'm going to go, I realized, oh wow, it's actually, I need to do something else than just running around in the forest. So I was thinking what I should do. I vividly remember one moment when I was just looking at the books and I was thinking where to start. And the one book that I opened was Problems in Mathematics. And I said, okay, so I will sit down and try to focus. So there was this one problem that I thought is probably difficult, but I sat down and I read the problem and I thought about it a bit, and then suddenly I knew how to solve it, and I solved it and I checked and the answer was correct, and it felt really satisfying. So I thought, okay, maybe this is something I want to do.
Thank you so much, Tereza, for speaking to us about our place in the universe.
Thank you for having me.
If you're looking for more astronomy educational resources, check out ESA Education's Teach with Astronomy webpage. And keep an eye out for more videos coming from ESA Education.